Hello, this is Arnaud Delorme, and this is part three of ICA applied to EEG data. This part is how do you actually apply ICA to EEG data. And so first, I need to explain a concept, which is the concept of super Gaussian versus sub Gaussian sources. So if you have a source that's perfectly Gaussian, has a kurtosis of zero, if I have a source that's sub-Gaussian, like the one we saw in the previous presentation, that's a kurtosis that's less than zero. And if you have a biological source, it's usually a very peaky distribution, so like EEG, and it's called a super-Gaussian source. And so when you apply ICA, this is important. So on the left here, this is what I showed in a previous video. So this is for a type of sub-Gaussian source. For EEG data is super Gaussian, so it would look more like what's on the right of this slide. And when it looks like this, you need to apply, so this is the axis of the source, you need to apply a transformation. So we pass the distribution through a nonlinearity right here, and so we can transform this source into a source on which we can calculate entropy as we showed in the previous video. And then once we do that, so it's exactly the same process that we showed in the previous video, we can recover the original axis for the source. So the only difference here is that we apply, we compute the priority distribution, density distribution, and we apply this nonlinearity before calculating the entropy. So how does that work on real data? So this is actual data here, and you can see two electrodes here, PZ and FZ, and the little wiggly line is time point, so that's the EEG signal through time. And so once we apply, here you see it's called logistic transform. When we apply the logistic transform, we can see that now it fills most of the square, it's most of the surface, so we can calculate the entropy and we have a relatively uniform distribution when we look at these two components here, PMP and P3B. And numerically, if you look at the data, so this is here, so you have the IC activity and you have the EEG data on the in blue, and then you calculate the weight matrix, so that's the ICA matrix. So this is how it would look like. So you have the data on top, you do a simple matrix multiplication, and then you obtain the ICA activity. If you want, you can also do the inverse, which is you take, you can calculate the data from applying the inverse weight matrix to the ICA activity. And what's interesting here is if we look at the column of the inverse weight matrix, we get the scalp topographies. And as we'll see in a subsequent video, by zeroing out the IC activity of some artifacts, troll components, we can remove these artifacts from the EEG data. So if you don't really understand what is ICA, this is really the two slides to remember, this simple matrix calculation. All the rest I showed you was about calculating this weight matrix and inverse weight matrix. But once you've done that, it's very simple matrix multiplications. There is assumption when you apply ICA to EEG. First, the first assumption is that the mixing is linear at scalp sensors, and this is mostly true. This is Maxwell equations of electrical propagation, and then the propagations or delays are negligible. This is also true in the sense that the propagation delays are close to the speed of light. So at the time scale we're interested in, which is from 1 hertz to 100 or even 1000 hertz, this is really negligible. Then that the component time courses are independent, so that the components are truly independent in the brain. And that's not their reasonable assumption. But what saves us here is that ICA, most ICA algorithms are called what's called maximum projection algorithm, and they will find a solution that's maximally independent. So they don't have to be fully independent, they only have to be maximally independent. And finally, the number of components should be less than the number of channel. And again, this is not necessarily a reasonable assumption. You can imagine that every single neuron in the brain, or even every single synapse, could be an independent contributor to the EEG signal. But what ICA will do is that it will find the source which contribute the most to the EEG signal and then apply some sort of cutoff. So you won't see the ones that don't contribute much to the EEG signal. And so that's what I was mentioning here, the limit that ICA impose on the number of independent components that can be isolated. The type of independent we can see in EEG, there's many different types, as we'll see in the next slide. Artifacts, stimulus-locked activity, response-locked activity, non-phase-locked activity, event-modulated oscillatory activity, overlapping maps and spectra. And so here is a sample EEG ICA decomposition. So here I'm just showing the data. And so you have selected channels. Here we only have 9 channels, and you see the some frontal channel, some occipital channel. We apply ICA, and this word being presented through time. We apply ICA, and this is what we get. We get component topography and component time courses. And here, the first two components are eye blinks. Here, in this case, it isolated 2 components. Then we have components, brain components. So we have frontal, parietal, theta, central theta, frontal midline theta, so components with different topographies, which sometimes overlap. And we also have occipital alpha components. In this case, we have 2 occipital alpha components. And then finally, we have ECG, so the heart. So even though we didn't have a heart channel here, ICA was able to extract heart signal from the EEG itself. And we have temporal muscle, so here we see the muscle spike for temporal muscle activity. So all these components are mixed together to create what's on the top, which is the real EEG, in which they're all mixed together. So it's a powerful way to separate this cognitive and artifactual processes. And here I have one last slide for this presentation on the difference of applying ICA to EEG versus applying ICA to fMRI. So when you look at EEG, so that's one of the slides I showed, the ICA activity are the time course of the components, and then the column of the inverse weight matrix are the scalp topographies. When you look at fMRI, it's applied in a spatial domain because you have many voxels and very few time points. So now the ICA activities are actually spatial 3D volumes of fMRI activation. And now the inverse weight matrix are the time course, of the components. So I wanted to thank you for your attention, and I'll see you on the next video.